The title for this session is Assessing and Measuring Well-Being. This session was part of the 17th Annual Child Welfare Waiver Demonstration Projects Meeting, which took place on September 1st through 3rd, 2015. The moderator is Anne Fromnecht.
My name is Anne Fromnecht, and I'm a research associate at James Bell Associates. And, you know, I'm really excited to be able to be here talking with you guys about assessing and measuring well-being. And, you know, we all just heard from some waiver demonstrations and Dr. Lyons about the cans and had a great plenary talking about well-being. But well-being has really been a cross-cutting thread throughout this meeting. Yesterday, we heard from Commissioner Lopez about the importance of early education and higher education. We also heard from Sheila Pyres about using Medicaid to pay for behavioral and mental health services. And I'm so happy that we have a session now that's devoted to assessing and measuring well-being. And we've had federal guidance about the different domains of well-being, but we all know that it can be challenging to come up with a common definition of well-being. And as evaluators, we all know it's really difficult to assess and evaluate anything if you don't know what it is. So rather than defining well-being as a concept, as waiver demonstrations, you've really had to think about what the needs are of your target populations, and then to identify the well-being outcomes that you'd like to achieve for that target population, and then select those interventions you think will help you achieve those outcomes. And you've been working as evaluators and program staff to identify the different indicators of those well-being outcomes. And I think our two presentations today provide some really nice examples of the process that they went through in order to come up with the different indicators of well-being and also to talk about some of the analyses that they've conducted. So first I'll provide a little background about the purpose of this breakout session and how we got to the point where we are. I'll also give an overview of the use of well-being instruments in waiver demonstrations. And then we'll hear from our presenters about the multi-level analysis of well-being. And first we'll hear from Tyler Allen and Thad Paul from the Colorado Department of Human Services about their use of the treatment outcome package. And next, we'll hear from Dr. Mary Armstrong about Florida's multi-level analysis to compare well-being outcomes across regions. And I've asked each of them in their presentations to spend a little bit of time at the beginning to talk about how their waiver demonstrations have conceptualized well-being to provide some context about the process that they went through. The reason we're having this breakout session today is to build on some of the topics and questions that were raised during the peer learning well-being webinar that was held earlier this spring. We also have heard this topic come up often as interest by all the jurisdictions, and also as we've reviewed your evaluation plans and conversations that we've had with all of you. We also want to use it as a chance to explore different approaches to assessing and measuring well-being. And our examples today are the multi-level analysis of well-being. And we also hope that it will serve as a chance for you all to connect with one another about the different, that you might be using the same well-being instruments, and hopefully will lead to some further peer discussion and peer learning. This table provides an overview of the well-being instruments that waiver demonstrations are currently using. And I will mention that the instruments that are listed here, these can be used for different purposes. So some of them are being used for programmatic reasons and case planning, while others are being used as part of the evaluation, or it could be both. And this information was drawn from the completed initial design and implementation reports and from your evaluation plans. And so for those states that have not yet started implementing and don't have an improved EIDR, they're not yet represented on this table. But this just gives you an idea of the broad range of instruments that are being used. And as you can see in what we heard from this morning, the majority of folks are using the CANS or a modified version of the CANS. In addition to the validated tools, there are additional data sources that you can use to help inform your well-being outcomes. And I've listed some here. So examples for family and participant surveys, Washington, Wisconsin, and Oregon are all using some type of family survey or interview. There's also Indiana's using a family case manager survey. CFSR indicators. Mary's going to talk with us about Florida's use of CFSR indicators as a measure of well-being. AFCARS, Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania is also using quality service review measures as well as Florida. And as we've seen even this morning, Wisconsin and Tennessee are incorporating well-being outcomes into their SACWIS. Also, Oregon has started to work towards incorporating well-being data into the SACWIS system. And SCA, Florida, and also Illinois IB3. So you can see there's a pretty wide range of sources of information that can help inform these well-being outcomes. I'll also mention using administrative data from other systems. So Colorado and Florida are also using data from their Medicaid systems to help inform well-being outcomes. So we can come back to this at the end if there are any specific questions, and maybe have a group discussion about different ways that you all are using these additional data sources to help inform well-being outcomes. But for now, I will hand it over to Tyler and Thad to talk with us about Colorado's use of the TOP.
The title of the first presentation is Multi-Rater Collection of Well-Being Data, How Colorado's Use of the Treatment Outcome Package, or TOP, has been used for case planning and evaluation.
Thank you, Anne. Good morning, everyone. My name is Tyler Allen. I'm the Title IV Waiver Administrator for the state of Colorado. With me today is Thad Paul. He is the Deputy Division Manager in Larimer County. The state of Colorado tends to do things, the state and the counties try to do things together. We'll talk about why in a moment. The thing about Thad and I recognize this room is mostly evaluators, probably. Thing about Thad and I, we're both programs people, so we represent the group of people who, want our cake and eat it too, and then expect after the fact for you to tell us that it was very good for us, and in fact have another bite. Not that it always works that way. So we both sit on our evaluation subcommittee, so we're very well informed as to the evaluation process. But as questions get very specific around research, I might look around the room to see if my evaluator is in the room. Throw the ball out back that way. So the overview of what we're going to talk about, I'm going to talk about the context of well-being measurement in general in Colorado, as Ann mentioned. I'll move that into kind of what we learned in our discussions around that and our history with well-being. And then I'm really going to try to provide as much time as possible for Thad to talk, because he's going to talk in greater detail about the treatment outcome package and what Larimer County is doing with that, and then what outcomes are associated with the treatment outcome package. It's kind of a different way of looking at things. Features of Colorado. Colorado is one of those county-administered state-supervised systems. The second bullet point there, we have a lot of variation within the state. We're proud of the fact that we are a county-administered state, largely due to the fact that very heavy density in the metropolitan areas, very large spaces in some of the rural areas, with low populations, what works well for one county might not work well for the next county. And so we have a great deal of flexibility built into our 4E waiver for exactly that same reason.
Colorado's Title IV-E waiver demonstration consists of 5 interventions implemented in up to all 64 counties.
What works in a very small or very large but small population rural county is going to look very different from what works in Denver County or Fort Collins up in Larimer County. So that's kind of where Colorado is at. There's also a lot of other initiatives that are taking place in Colorado that has similar outcomes associated or intended outcomes associated to the 4E waiver. I've listed a few of the statewide ones there.
The other initiatives related to child welfare include the Colorado Practice Model, the Collaborative Management Program, Differential Response, Permanency by Design, and the Trauma-Informed System of Care.
Counties also have their own initiatives that they might be doing, and so there's a lot of factors in everything we look at. The reason I bring this all up is you can probably imagine that we put a very heavy load on our evaluators for this very reason. We have very flexible use of what we're doing in the state on a whole, and there's a lot of things going on. So kind of identifying the separate pieces, it's a lot to ask of our evaluators. So we're very grateful to have such HSRI who's very, very flexible with us. So, this isn't our foray into the venue, first foray into the venue of well-being in Colorado. I put some other tools that we've used up on the board there.
There are three child welfare tools related to well-being measurement. One, the North Carolina Family Assessment Scales. Two, the Colorado Client Assessment Record. And three, the Child and Adolescent Needs Assessment.
The one I really want to highlight is the North Carolina Family Assessment Scales. We call it the NCFAS. Back in 2007, Colorado had a big effort to make that part of our practice and really looking at where families are at and assessing them as we went in terms of looking at well-being. That didn't exactly take off as we had intended. We put a lot of effort into getting it off the ground. What we found is we didn't have partnership everywhere. Counties were administering it differently or struggling to administer it at all. And what we really realized walking out of that was, we did eventually back out, is that there, if you're not overseeing very cautiously and you don't have popular consent going into it, you're not going to get good data out of it. And so it was a big lesson learned for us as a state. We had integrated into our SACWIS. We had made a big commitment behind it, and it just didn't take off, and we realized we can't trust what this is telling us. I bring it up only as context for now we're getting to the point where we have to be measuring well-being again, not just because we're told to, but also because it is the right thing to do. We need to be considering all levels of assessment in terms of the three pillars of child welfare: safety, permanency, and well-being. We need to be able to identify what well-being is. The second part of that slide is that there are other agencies within Colorado that are struggling with the same question of how do you define well-being? And there's been a lot of work groups that have put energies into how do you define well-being? And what we have is this tremendous range of different ways to look at that question of defining well-being.
Agencies and work groups that have worked to define well-being include the CDHS Office of Economic Security, the Colorado Association of Family and Children's Agencies, Colorado Work Support Strategies, and many community agencies.
Ann mentioned early on that you can't start with a definition to well-being. That was what we were intending to do. Give us a definition, then we'll find out the best way to measure that definition. We can't do that. I've heard it summarized as, theoretically, everything in human existence could fall under the scope of well-being. There is no thing that is not well-being that relates to anything any of us do. And so if it's so broad, what do you do? What do you do with that? And all these different parties have different interests in it. Classic example is the Office of Economic Security published some material about defining well-being. They looked at a lot of their community partners, found out how they were measuring well-being, and a lot of that was really geared towards family well-being, access to food, standard of living questions, access to medical care, a lot of those questions which are fairly broad from a child welfare perspective. This is small writing, and I don't expect anybody to be able to read that. In fact, you don't need to. I want to just put it up as an example. Our process in this was originally trying to say, if we're not going to start with defining well-being, how do we move forward on this practice? And so we have a steering committee, an executive oversight committee over our waiver, and that committee has subcommittees to it. One of those subcommittees is an evaluation subcommittee. The purpose of that group is to help answer some of these questions and give guidance and support to the oversight committee and report back to our evaluators and go back to our evaluators and help them understand what the process is. So it's really a learning experience. Counties get together. There's county membership on that committee, state membership on that committee. Our evaluators, of course, are present in it. And it's really our brainstorming group. We sat down and we said, what do we already have going on? What are potential things? Different people in the group were championing different tools. And this is a list. This is actually the abridged list. It was much longer to start. And we kind of came up with pros and cons within our state for each of the tools.
A chart shows the pros and cons of tools, such as a scorecard, CSTAT, and ROM, the treatment outcome package, various forms of the CANS assessment, NCFAS, trauma screens, and ARD review instruments.
So the point of this is really kind of to show you what the process was for us of saying, what do we do? Our intention was to hand this list to our oversight committee and say, now please make a decision in terms of how we define and measure well-being in the state. They very graciously handed that very hot potato back to us with a simple question of, what do you recommend that we do? Fortunately, we had a plan B. Our plan B was to recommend a pilot, which we would use three tools that were already in existence in some way within the state to answer one very basic research question, which was, do any of these tools show us anything differently than we would see out of just measuring permanency and safety? If not, then this is not the right direction to be going. If yes, now we're honing in on something. We're knowing a way to go. And so the three pilots that we came up with were, two of our interventions are trauma-informed assessment and trauma-informed treatment. And the door that opens into trauma-informed assessment at a child welfare perspective is the trauma screen that we administer. So one of the tools we wanted to use was doing a pre and post with the trauma screen, seeing if trauma symptomology changed within an episode of child welfare involvement. And that's a very narrow scope of a way to measure well-being, but it seemed to be significant to us. The second is there is, as you might have seen this morning, we do use the CANS. In Colorado, there's a program called the Treatment Foster Care. And so it's focused on a very specific subgroup. It's children, foster care children within the specific foster care treatment pilot. That we're hoping soon would start generating data and we can look at what that starts to tell us. And the third initiative is happening in Larimer County, and it's why it's so important that Thad's here today. They are using the treatment outcome package and kind of, I think they made a commitment about a year and a half ago now to really looking at this tool and saying, does it measure well-being any differently? So those are three options. This is kind of the lessons learned and things to consider page if you are at a point as a state in asking, how do we measure well-being? How do we define it? How do we want to measure outcomes associated? Where do we start with this whole thing? Obviously, there's what's the reliability and validity of tools and how easy is it to use? That's an important consideration. We don't want to go back into the process where we can't get popular consent from our county partners to utilize the tool because it's too cumbersome for a caseworker to manage. But I'd really like to point out the next one, more importantly than just ease of use, is what's the impact on case practice? I don't want to give a tool that is easy to whip off, but it's not usable at a case level. We can count on our caseworkers to give us accurate, reliable data if it's informing what they do day in and day out. And so that was a big part of the question. How is this help guiding your case practice? As we heard this morning, it's so important not just to look at this as a point in time assessment. It's not the tool, it's how the tool interacts with the practice. And that's also why we thought it was important that Thad and I, as program people, were here taking part in this discussion. A couple of other things, discuss what's the capacity to measure change and how sensitive to changes are there. One of the concerns for us was sometimes you're dealing with very marginalized population. If it's not sensitive enough to see small changes on one end of the spectrum, then we might not be gathering the data that we otherwise could gather. The last thing that I'd like to point out before I turn it over to Thad is the idea of the last bullet point there. It's more more meaningful to identify the scope of well-being than the definition of well-being. As I said before, well-being can be anything. It can mean anything at all. The scope of well-being is you're saying, how do I narrow this definition down enough that it's something that I can see some change in? Because if I go with the Office of Economic, I lost it, the one I discussed earlier that was all about more standard of living stuff, how much impact is child welfare going to be able to have across all of those domains that they're looking at? Probably very small, maybe in some of them more significantly, but as a whole, we're looking at small change, if any. On the other side of the spectrum, if I narrow my scope too much, I might miss the heart of what I'm trying to find. So how do I kind of be flexible and find the right scope for looking at well-being is really where we're at with our question. And as we go into this pilot program over the next year, a lot of interested eyes are on Larimer County, who said, I think we may have found a good scope to start with this. And so, no further ado, I'll give you Thad Paul from Larimer County.
Thad Paul is with the Larimer County Department of Human Services. The title of his presentation is TOP, Treatment Outcome Package. The slide shows the logos for Kids Insight, a Colorado program that uses TOP, Wellness Check, and the Colorado Department of Human Services.
Thank you, Tyler. So just to give you a little perspective of Larimer County, so we often reference Big Ten counties in Colorado. So the Big Ten counties reference 85% of the child population, so Larimer County is like sixth or seventh in child pop in the state. And for those that don't know Colorado, Larimer is known as the one that likes to do everything a little bit different. So, and thus we led us to TOP. Tyler mentioned that we went to the TOP looking to it as a well-being measure. To be honest, we went to it because we saw a lot of benefits from measuring our providers, measuring the service need of children, identifying or connecting the right child to the right service provider. So our belief is that actually that TOP does much more than well-being, but well-being is a component of it and obviously the focus of today. I'd also say, and Tyler mentioned several of the initiatives that the state and counties have, as part of our struggle has been with getting the TOP to be as useful as it could be, is some initiative fatigue across the state. We have so many different things changing. You're constantly adding new stuff to caseworkers who are already stressed, and oftentimes high turnover rates creates more stress. So there's constantly been that struggle of, is this just another tool, another flavor of the day, or making it meaningful? We heard that earlier today, making it meaningful is where the real action is and where the real change is, but obviously getting to that point is part of the journey. So Kids Insight, well, so that last slide, this is, the TOP is, it's kind of a culmination of, and it stands for Treatment Outcome Package. It's a culmination with Kids Insight, as well as Casey Family kind of helped to launch it. The reality is that the TOP was initially designed to be used within the mental health world. It has adult functions, what they call the adult TOP, as well as the child TOP. And there's a huge amount of data within mental health functioning. It's just now being rolled out to child welfare. So there's about five different child welfare sites across the nation, Larimer being one of them. Larimer is also working with six other counties to create a consortium in Colorado that will actually be 50% of our population, which will also start using the TOP in the next year. So we'll have a lot broader data set than just little Larimer's practice, so that will hopefully influence our future of the use of TOP. It's a web-based application. That's awesome for our mobile staff. What's not awesome is that it's not embedded in our SACWIS system. So it is an added work, right? So every time you add something to child welfare caseworkers, the red flags go up and the defiance and the pushback comes. So there's a constant work to show how you can use this information to change your practice and interventions, but it's still an ongoing work that needs to be done. And it's a platform. So what I heard from Dr. Lyons today is that the CANS is in essence a tool to help conversations. I would say the TOP is the same, but the TOP does cost. And what we're paying for is actually the platform. And I'll kind of go into a little more detail on this shortly. But in essence, how a caseworker can initiate raters for a child, And within 15 minutes, they can get a report that's actually usable, right? So it's a platform that does some algorithm stuff, and I'm not the researcher, so don't ask me those types of questions, but there's information behind the scenes that creates algorithms to figure out where their risk scores basically are, okay? Tyler mentioned the trauma screen. So in Larimer, we're one of the trauma intervention sites. So initially were 11, now it's broadened out to a broader perspective across the state. So we just kind of wanted to give a little perspective what's the difference between the trauma screen and the top. Like Tyler said, we believe the trauma screen can do well-being measures as well. At this point in time, the trauma screen to this point has only been up front, not on the back side. So that's the next iteration. We'll be doing trauma screens at closure, so we can kind of see if that is a well-being measure. The top has multiple raters. Obviously, the trauma screen is in our system is done by the child welfare worker and entered into our SACWIS system. Right now, our practice with the top is you initiate the top at least every 90 days. So we start one if we're going to offer case services. We do one 30 days after that initial, and then every 90 days following that. We have reports that are generated from top, and it's specific to Larimer County and our new consortium. So being that we use the platform that Kids Insight has, they don't have the capacity to to open it up for everybody across the state, so it's a slow intervention to see if this actually works. Why top it out for us? We think it provides multiple functions. Multi-rater measures interventions. There's opportunity, once you get enough data in the set, you can find the providers that do really well with certain types of children based on their domain scores, and then you get better outcomes when you start matching the right kid with the right service. And there's multiple questions. So there's about 12, 13 domains across the top based on the child. Multiple questions feed into each one of those domains. And then our hope, and we've contracted with Colorado State University, which is in our backyard, the Social Work Research Center, and they're gonna do some research based on the top scores, the services, and then the child welfare outcomes to kind of do a cross look of all those. So here's the top factors, or domains, I guess is what I referenced it as earlier. The one at the child top on the left, the both in the middle, and the adolescent top on the right. So basically, there's two tools. There's the child tool and the adolescent tool. And within some of those, there's questions that go across systems. So the child top has only those specific things on the left there. Lack of assertiveness, lack of resiliency, separation anxiety. The middle category that domain shows up on both the child and the adolescent top. And then obviously the right side is the top, is the adolescent version. We feel like there's multiple of these domains that are indicators of child well-being. Probably all of them, like Tyler said, but some of them that we can kind of focus on are lack of assertiveness, lack of resiliency for our children, eating issues, conduct disorder, sleep problems, violence, school functioning, social functioning. A lot of this is really focused on the social and emotional issues that children might be having in our communities. Our belief is obviously is that we can address those, we lower those issues, then they become easier to live with in the community, and thus those connections start to grow. The top is done, is when you do a top, you're supposed to only look back the last couple weeks. So as many of us in child welfare know, a child becomes the label that brought them into the system. They're a victim of sexual abuse. They're a fire setter. And then that carries throughout their whole case life. As a caseworker, you're calling up a foster parent and they are asking you if there's past concerns that they need to be aware of. Well, you have to tell them about the fire setting that happened 10 years ago, and then all of a sudden that just is a continuation. What the top does is really allows us to really focus on the last couple weeks of this child's life and to measure those changes. And what we found is actually our kids ask for tops to be done on them because they feel like I can show people that I'm making change. Quit talking about me of who I was, right? So I think this is probably the part that we wanted, that many people were interested in. This is what we call the multi-rater report. So I'll do this one, and the next slide will be the multi-rater over time.
A sample top multi-rater report is provided. The top of the report includes the rating scale with four potential ratings: healthy, mid, moderate, and severe. An option to select incomplete is also available for raters. The report includes ratings on the following domains: attention, conduct, depression, psychosis, sleep, suicide, violence, mania, substance abuse, school or work functioning, and social functioning. A legend on the right denotes symbols for each rater.
Each person, so if you're looking at this, the legend on the right kind of references who the assessor is or who completed the top. So how this system works is that the caseworker has a heavier lift in the initial, is that they put into the system both physical attributes, so demographics, but also medications, physical health, and then there's the 50-something questionnaire that gets generated for each of these raters. The caseworker has the ability to decide who's going to be a rater on the case. Our focus is to have four or five really high-quality raters, the idea of being focused on caseworker, therapist, child, and whoever is the caregiver. Ideally, you want both the parent and, if it's an out-of-home placement, the resource parent caregiver. And then you do that on a consistent basis. Now, you can always add new people to this. Obviously, they wouldn't be involved in the research process if they're not consistent throughout the time. But it's still, our belief is that you give a much broader perspective of what this child really looks like from all of these lenses. Historically, caseworkers looking at it from the lens of safety and permanency. Parents, foster parents are living with these children day in and day out. They see a lot more of what the child's daily behaviors look like than what a caseworker does. So ultimately what you see here is the different scores. On the right-hand side is the incomplete battery. So in essence, this tool says, if you don't know the answer to the question, don't answer it. We don't want you to skew the data. If you don't know, the next time you answer it, you might start paying attention to some of those questions that you weren't able to answer. But the flip side, don't put it in because of what you think it is. It's only what you know within the last 2 weeks. And then you can kind of see where different raters fall. When I talked about this being a communication tool, what we find is areas where there's drastic differences between raters is where our caseworkers like to use this as an opportunity to have conversations, whether it's with resource parents, residential facility workers, biological parents or the child. This allows you to sit down, caseworkers to sit down and say, tell me, I'm sitting over here, you're sitting over here, let's have a conversation about what you're seeing and that I'm missing, or vice versa, right? This information gets brought into our family meetings that also occur every 90 days, so it allows an opportunity for the whole team to have this sitting in front of them. Let's have a conversation about why we're having differences so we can try to get to the same page and then really focus our interventions. We also like the top in that it has no ceiling effects. Now, I hear Dr. Lyons talk about being able to measure minute changes. The benefit of this one that we believe is that it does measure those minute changes. So those, when it goes out to 9 there, that's standard deviations. It continues to spread out if you have so severe of a child that's out there with their behaviors. So we can see minute changes. So even if in our world, that category there that says severe, if you have a child that's way over in the severe category and moves a little bit, but is still in severe, in many tools, that child just looks like a severe child. And our tool will start to say, oh, we've tried this new intervention. We're starting to see a shift. Is it that intervention? Is it something else? We don't know, but let's watch that process. This also allows us to measure placement changes, disruptions. We can do the tool more often than every 90 days, so it allows you to really focus in on, there's something big going on in this child's life. We're going to do it every 30 days just to see if things are changing and moving, so we're all paying attention. This one is the multi-rater report over time.
A sample top multi-rater report over time is provided. This report references ratings from a previous assessment on the first line and ratings from the current assessment on the second line to illustrate changes.
So the line, that little line that draws between the two, where that connects is the average of the score of all those raters. So obviously, if your line's going this way, it's moving towards the more severe. So the top line is the first iteration. The second bar graph is the follow-up iteration. And you can see which direction people are going. So the average helps us kind of get a sense on which direction it's going. Oftentimes for us, it's about which direction is the client going. We oftentimes, like I said earlier, our youth love to have this as their voice. We lose their voice. This gives them an opportunity to score it. You can have those conversations. A lot of folks worry about, are they just BSing through the tool, the child? Obviously, a lot of the research out there is that a tool that is scored, a child scoring a tool on paper, oftentimes give you much more information than the conversation that a caseworker would be having with them. So it allows for deeper conversations. And ultimately, that's what we believe this tool helps us identify. The goal is, let's see, what else do we have? You can add raters. Again, the incomplete battery is over there. You can see, notice this one, this is the same child. We've had many more people added to being raters. And then you can still get the perspective of multiple systems or multiple agencies. This is some of our initial look of how things are looking for our kids at this point.
The next slide shows children making improvements in 12 of 13 domains, with significant improvements in 5 domains.
So this is the child version. The dark green graph is the first iteration of the top. The second one is the following iterations. So in essence, what this graph represents is 0 is the baseline, is the national average. When the top was created, my understanding is Dr. Krause did a lot of work in schools and other settings with families to try to get a baseline for the standard population. And then this is how our child welfare kids look in regards to that baseline 0. So the higher you go, the more severe or the more concerning the issues. If you go down below to the negative scores, that's actually considered strengths. Okay? So obviously, we've had improvements in almost all of the domains. There's several there that have very significant improvements over them. And what's been really interesting is not only is this helping all of our systems recognize the positive changes that are happening, which leads to discussions of maybe this child can go home now instead of my concern about sending them home, but it also is actually giving well-being scores for our caseworkers. They're seeing the positive work that they're doing, and then there's more emphasis to reuse this within the family meeting and the family settings and with case planning. So they're encouraged. We also provide incentives to caseworkers, so we do top stories of the month. Caseworkers submit stories about this is how I used it and this is how it changed my practice. They get a $20 gift card to whatever place they want to use it for. So it's some incentives, and then we share those stories across the agency, so it keeps the energy and the momentum going. Make sure I covered everything I wanted to cover. So if we don't, so our focus in Larimer as part of the trauma project is to do trauma interventions. So if we don't address some of the concerns with those children on that last score, this is what our adolescents look like.
A bar graph illustrates adolescents' average first and follow-up top scores across all multiple top raters. The findings illustrate that adolescents are showing improvements on all domains, with significant improvements in ADHD, depression, manic, psychosis, suicide, violence, school or work functioning, and social functioning.
So you'll notice their scores are much more severe in range. Some of that may be due to the fact that they have more ability to capture their history and their experience and their behaviors when they're scoring. The reality is our belief is that if we don't do it right at the child, do the right interventions with the child, our adolescents will always end up more severe. And those are one of our biggest cost drivers, right? Those are the ones that end up in residential care and group homes and are the high cost and end up in juvenile justice. Our belief is if we're addressing the issues before, we're decreasing their behaviors and increasing self-esteem, increasing connections, and then increasing social functioning. Like I said earlier, the youth are asking for that for their own top. We try to do tops as young as we can go. The goal is 10 at least, you're always doing a top. Now there's circumstances that you might not always do it that way, but it's their voice, and we believe this is their life, obviously, and they should have a voice and input on the direction it should be going. So that's kind of the roundabout version of top. I'm sure we can do more questions later about specifics if you have those. The last slides are, is that you?
That is me.
Thad Paul completes presentation. Tyler Allen comes to podium to speak.
Oh. Is there a button that I... Okay, we're good. So I actually kind of spoke to this stuff a little bit earlier on. This was the three tools that we're looking to use. And then those are the broad research questions I brought up before. Do the tools show different... The first one I mentioned, does well-being measurement offer different outcomes than traditional permanency safety measures? And then after that, which tools show different outcomes? And then what tools generate findings that more clearly illustrate the scope of well-being. So it's just the idea of the whole statewide pilot we're doing. Obviously, we're very interested in what Larimer County is turning up because they have a great level of detail in those specific domains. And I think the last slide is just our contact information. Thank you.
The contact information is Tyler Allen, Title 4E Waiver Administrator, Colorado Department of Human Services. His email address is tyler.allen@state.co.us. And Thaddeus Paul, Deputy Division Manager, Larimer County Department of Human Services, can be reached via email at paul xxtj at colarimer.co.us. Mary Armstrong from the University of South Florida approaches the podium and begins her presentation, which is entitled Well Indicators and Multilevel Analysis. The collaborators on this project are Mary Armstrong, PhD, and Svetlana Yampolskaya, PhD.
Good morning, everybody. So this is really a nice combination because the panel that Anne put together, I've been thinking as Tyler and Thad were presenting. So while all of you who are program people have been struggling over the last 5 years or so around how do we measure child well-being, we as evaluators, of course, have also been challenged with how do we assess and measure child well-being as part of our 4E waiver evaluations. And I think I just want to give a shout out to the Children's Bureau. This has been a struggle, I think, for us. And I think that really Tyler explained very well how difficult it is to get our arms around child well-being. But I think as a community of practice, it was one of, we needed to do it. I think we understood much better 6 years ago child safety and child permanency than we understood child well-being. And we weren't very focused on it. So I think that's really one of the positive outcomes that we have right now is trying to get our arms around this. So let me tell you what I'm going to be talking about in my session part of this presentation. So I'm going to be talking about how we conceptualized and measured child well-being indicators in Florida's previous 4E waiver evaluation. We are just beginning a new Florida 4E waiver extension, and we are the evaluators, the University of South Florida, for the new waiver. I'm not going to be talking here about how we're going to be measuring child well-being in the new waiver. We can answer questions about that afterwards. So I'm going to be focusing on the previous waiver and what we have done. I'm also going to be talking about multi-level modeling as a research method that can help us sort out how to assess child well-being, and then talk about a little discussion of the implications for the measurement of child well-being and the use of multi-level modeling, and then we'll open it up for discussion. So just a little background. I know that we all know this, but just to remind us that ASFA, the Adoption and Safe Families Act, way back in 1997, really added this notion of child well-being to permanency and safety. And it also required that child welfare systems assure and assess well-being. And so when we went back, and as we were doing this same struggle about trying to figure out what well-being could be, what we kind of went back to is, has there been appropriate services to meet children's educational needs? Are there adequate services to meet children's physical and mental health needs? And is there an enhanced family capacity to address their children's needs? So that's kind of the framework. That's where we began as an evaluation team as we were on this journey around how to assess child well-being. Some of the challenges, and really Tyler said this more eloquently than I can, but it's a complex and multidimensional concept. I think there's still a lack of clear consensus regarding the definition of child well-being. And also, it's a construct where there are many interrelations and there's a lot of interdependence overlay between these dimensions of child well-being. Also, and this is where multi-level modeling, I think, can be helpful from a research perspective, is that child well-being is affected by multiple factors. So what I'm going to be talking about is two examples from our evaluation of the previous 4E waiver, using data from two sources to measure child well-being. The first one is our Florida Department of Children and Families Quality Assurance Indicators. And I think that one of the reasons that we decided to use, to really build, well, there's two reasons, I think, why we decided to build on the department's quality assurance program. And the first one is related to what Tyler said, what John Lyon said earlier. We really wanted to take a look, to build on what's being used to change practice, to change caseworker practice. And that's what I think a quality assurance system is all about, right? Is measuring the quality of child welfare practice and trying to drive changes in that practice. So, and also for us as evaluators, the whole notion of burden. You know, when you're a child welfare evaluator, you're in there for the long run with your partners. And I think we're very cognizant of the burden of data collection. And so as much as we can use data that's already been corrected, collected, we try to do that. So, and the second indicator that we used is the National Survey of Child and Adolescent Wellbeing, NASCA. And the reason we decided to do that is the other question we always get asked as evaluators is, well, in your evaluation, are you comparing how Florida, your state, is doing in comparison with other states? So we were looking for a data collection system that already existed and that was across multiple states. So that's one of the reasons why we ended up using NASCA. So, as I said, our first data source was Florida's Quality Assurance Practice Standards. So at that point in time, the Florida Department of Children and Families had developed quality of practice standards to guide case management services and to provide direction for these quarterly quality assurance reviews that were taking place of child welfare case records. And the quality assurance standards had many purposes. One of them was to make sure that case managers were working in partnership with families. So there's was a lot of wonderful emphasis, I think, in these standards around, were caseworkers making efforts to create trust between the case manager and the caregiver? And were parents involved in assessments, case planning, and decision making? And also, were caseworkers, was there a partnership around providing services while focusing on the family's strengths and needs? We used those case management standards also in our evaluation, but I'm not going to be talking about them this morning. I'm going to focus more on the child well-being pieces. So the other important point, I think one of the other strengths of the quality assurance system was that they aligned beautifully and purposely with the Child and Family Service Review requirements. And so we decided to also, to use the CFSR standards also as we were looking at this. So we identified in partnership with the department, with our state partners, several quality of practice standards that represent these three domains of child well-being. Were the child's educational needs being met? Were their mental health needs being addressed? And were their physical and dental needs being addressed? So these are some examples of some of the DCF quality of practice standards and how they align with the CFSR items.
The next slide lists three Florida DCF quality of practice standards aligned with CFSR item 21, education needs of child. The three standards are as follows. 1. CM Standard 58, Educational Needs Assessment. Concerted efforts were made to assess the child's educational needs. 2. CM Standard 59, Educational Services. If educational needs were identified, the necessary educational services were engaged. And 3. CM Standard 60, Educational Service Outcomes. Services effectively reduced or resolved the issues that interfered with the child's education.
So these are related to the CFSR items around educational needs of the child. Here's a set of practice standards around the physical health of the child.
The slide lists four quality of practice standards aligned with CFSR item 22, physical health of the child. The four standards are 1. CM Standard 61, physical health needs assessment. Concerted efforts were made to assess the child's physical health needs. 2. CM Standard 62, physical health services. Concerted efforts were made to provide appropriate services to address the child's identified physical health needs. 3. CM Standard 63, dental health needs assessment. Concerted efforts were made to assess the child's dental health care needs. And 4. CM Standard 64, dental health services. Appropriate services were provided to address the child's identified dental health needs.
Here's the quality of practice standards that we selected that align with the CFSR item around ensuring that the mental health needs of the child are being met.
There are two quality of practice standards that were used and align with CFSR item 23, mental health of the child. Those two standards are 1. CM Standard 65, mental and behavioral health needs assessment. Assessment of the children's mental and behavioral health needs were conducted. And 2. CM Standard 66, mental and behavioral health services. Appropriate services were provided to meet the child's mental and behavioral health needs.
So what we did, what was our method? So how did we do this? So we looked at quality of practice standards, the data that had been collected across four different time periods. So we were looking at improvements over time. And then, as I mentioned before, we aligned these practice standards with the CFSR items to comport with the federal monitoring requirements. And we also, when it was also a PIP goal for Florida, we also built that into our assessment. And then it was very simple, actually, what we did. We looked at the percentage of reviewed cases that achieved the Florida case management standards, and then we compared them to the CFSR strength ratings and the PIP goals. So that's actually the process that we used, and our evaluation reports that are available online have lots of examples of how we did this. And there was good news and there was bad news, but I think it was also helpful because it was another way of giving feedback to our stakeholders in Florida about how we were doing around these practice standards and how we were doing looking at the CFSR standards and also at looking at Florida's program improvement plan. So our second data source that I want to talk about and was the child well-being indicators from NASCA. I think, well, let me just talk a little bit about, so the National Survey of Child and Adolescent Well-being is the data source that we're talking about. And we used cohorts 1 and cohorts 2. And what's really nice about NASCA is that it used a nationally representative sample of youth, birth to 14, who had been referred to the child welfare system for investigation of alleged abuse and neglect. A two-stage stratified sampling design was used to select the participants, including youth, caregivers, and caseworkers. And they ended up with 92 primary sampling units, which they call PSUs, which were predominantly called county child welfare agencies in 36 states. Within these geographic sampling units, data on child well-being were collected. So again, when we looked, and this is the reason that we decided to use, one of the reasons that we looked at NASCA is that it does have child well-being indicators. For example, physical health of the child. Children were perceived by caseworkers as needing services for a health problem. It also looked at dental health services and the mental health of the child, whether the child was receiving a formal assessment for emotional behavioral problems, regardless of perceived need, and If caseworkers perceived a child as needing services, did they receive a formal assessment for emotional behavioral attention problems? And then it also looks at mental and behavioral health services that were received. So, there were survey items that we selected, again, relating to the child's physical, mental health, and educational needs. And then we took these items from, and of course the other important thing is that there were PSUs within Florida that we were able to use. And so we used from the data from the Florida cohorts to compare well-being outcomes for families pre-waiver, because that was cohort one, and that also worked out really well, as compared to the post-4E waiver implementation period, which was 2008 to 2009. And then, as I mentioned earlier, the added advantage that we felt we brought to the evaluation by using the NASCA data is that we could illustrate how Florida was doing in comparison with other states across the country. And again, those findings are available in our previous waiver reports. For those of you who are evaluators, I think I will say that using the NASCA data, I think, is a wonderful data set. It's also challenging to use. My partner for this presentation, Svetlana Yampolskaya, received a lot of technical assistance around the use of it, and we value it very highly, but don't, you really do need, I think, to have the time and the energy to actually understand it and how to use it. So the second part of my presentation, Anne asked as part of the panel that I do a presentation around multi-level analysis and how it can be used to take a look at all the factors that are associated with child well-being. So one of the other things that we know about child well-being that actually Tyler said earlier, and so did our previous panel, that there are not only individual but also contextual and socioeconomic factors that affect child well-being. So the individual factors can include things like demographics, family structure, physical health problems. We also know that family and child well-being is very affected by contextual factors, neighborhood poverty level, community characteristics of the child welfare agency, right, that's providing the services. So so it's very important that we take into consideration those contextual factors as well as the individual factors. So a little bit about Florida's child welfare system. We are not county operated and state supervised as some of the other states that have been doing presentations have been talking about. Our child welfare system is called community-based care. It is privatized. We are a privatized child welfare system. All child welfare services, except for child protective investigations, have been outsourced to nonprofit lead agencies with responsibility for a geographic catchment area. So many of you talk about counties and how different counties, like Laramie County is not the same as the other counties in Colorado. Well, we have the same issue in Florida, but for us, it's really at the lead agency level, right? So we have 22 lead agencies in Florida that are responsible for child welfare services, and there's a lot of variation in these lead agencies' organizational characteristics, child welfare practices, the population served, what's their level of annual funding that they received, things like that. So we had our own variations that we were dealing with, and at the same time, we know that it's also true that children and families that are served by the same community-based care lead agency are affected by the same characteristics and the same contextual factors. So we had our own what we would call nested data structure that we were dealing with. So there's a lot of sources of non-independence of observations that we have to be aware of as evaluators, because observations may also be related because they come from the same subject, the same child, right? And this happens when we are measuring the same child at multiple points in time, repeated measures. Some of the other sources of non-independence is that children may come from the same cohort.
The slide includes a graph that illustrates the rates of maltreatment recurrence by fiscal year cohort. The graph shows a gradual decline in rates of maltreatment recurrence from 1996 through 2000. Rates of maltreatment recurrence start to increase beginning in 2001.
For example, all children who experienced maltreatment or were placed in out-of-home care during a specific year. And these are the kinds of measures that we use in our 4E waiver evaluation. I'm sure that many of the other evaluators do. This is an example, rates of maltreatment recurrence by fiscal year cohort, right? So another source of non-independence of observations when you have children and they're in the same cohort. We also have this issue of between versus within cluster effects. So we have factors that only vary between clusters, and we call those cluster level effects. So that the cluster level, we may have poverty rates, crime rates. We may also have longitudinal data where we've got race, ethnicity, and sex. However, any factor that varies within a cluster can also vary between clusters, right? So we have this issue of cluster effects both within a cluster and also between clusters that we're dealing with. So the second issue that I'm going to touch on is that we also have fixed versus random effects.
The slide includes additional information about fixed and random effects. Fixed effects include random variability that only occurs within subjects level 1. Random effects apply variable impact on outcomes, and variability occurs at level 1 and level 2. The use of random effects helps the study model variability.
Fixed effects are cluster level variation that we can account for by holding the cluster constant, represents parameters that are constant across groups and do not vary. And then we also have random effects that represent parameters that can vary across groups. So we have all of these issues that we're dealing with, and these are some of the reasons why we need multi-level analysis. So to come back to kind of what the reality, what common sense would tell us, as John Lyon said earlier, we have children and families that are served by multiple child welfare agencies, counties, community-based care lead agencies, that have different characteristics, such as size, funding level, specific practices. Maltreated children are from different counties that have different characteristics or different parts of the state, such as the median income level, crime index, rural versus urban. And also, if we want to look at changes in child well-being over time, then the changes are based on either cohorts, the same cohorts, or panels. So we're trying to take into consideration all of these issues. Multi-level analysis was actually, it's not that old, a statistical method of analysis. It was developed during the 1980s. You may know it as hierarchical lineal modeling. That's one of the other ways that it's referred to. So the advantage of multi-level analysis is that it allows us to consider the individual variables and the group level variables in the same analysis so that we don't have to choose one or the other. So it provides an ideal framework for combining data from several different sources, such as individual level data about an individual child and family, and county level data, or for us, lead agency data. And if the higher level clustering is not properly accounted for in the model that we use, then the inferences we make about other predictors may be incorrect. So we might infer a relationship where none actually exists.
Additionally, the violation of independence of data assumption leads to misestimated standard errors.
So, I'm going to give you an example of, and this actually it comes from an article that we've published. We have some copies of that article available. We can put them on the resource desk for you.
The title of the article is Contextual and Individual Level Predictors of Abused Children's Reentry into Out-of-Home Care, a Multilevel Mixture Survival Analysis, published in the journal Child Abuse and Neglect, Volume 35, pages 670 through 679. The authors are S. Yampolskaya, M. I. Armstrong, and T. King Miller.
So this is an example of looking, we were, of course, one of the things that we were very interested in our evaluation is the rates of reentry of children into care. So we were interested in taking a look at both the contextual and the individual level predictors of reentry into out-of-home care. We defined reentry, as many of you probably do, as a second entry into out-of-home care within 12 months of returning home. The sample included all children in the state of Florida who exited out-of-home care during a specific fiscal year, 2004-2005. And Svetlana did this data analysis. She used multilevel Cox regression. So our dependent variable is time to reentry. And we looked at multi-levels. Within level, we looked at the individual or the child factors, and I'll show you those in just a second. And then we also looked at lead agency variables. And simultaneously, we were able to examine the effects of both the contextual, the lead agency level, and the child characteristics.
The analysis also included an examination of mixture distribution, unobserved heterogeneity, for each level.
So this is the model that we took a look at. So, and you can see the within level predictors are child characteristics, gender, age, race, ethnicity, absence of caregiver, so on.
Additional within level predictors examined included emotional or physical problems, abuse, neglect, male single parent family, female single parent family, and substance abuse parent or parents. The between level predictors included presence of parent organization, number of counties per lead agency, cost per child, and retention of case management.
And then we also looked at the cluster level. So we looked at several characteristics of the lead agencies that were serving that child. And so then we were able to see if both predictors within level and between level had an impact on time to reentry. Some of our findings, so at the child level, what we learned, and this will be no surprise, but was that younger age, being placed in out-of-home care because of neglect, and having physical health problems corresponded to a decreased likelihood for reentry. And then at the lead agency level, lower average expenditures per child. Contracting out case management services. Our lead agencies can either do case management services themselves or they can contract it out to other providers. So contracting out case management services were both associated with faster reentry into out-of-home care. So those were our findings from taking a look from using the multi-level modeling. So in summary, I guess the one of my take-home messages for you is that you can, without doing primary data collection, it is possible to look at child well-being outcomes using administrative data sets. And you can also do secondary data analysis of studies that have been based, have been done nationally with nationally representative samples. And then my final point is, that it's very important, obviously, to take into account both contextual and individual factors when you're assessing changes in child well-being over time, and multi-level modeling is a statistical method, a way of taking into account both the contextual factors and also the individual factors. So, thank you very much, and I think we're gonna open it up to questions. Anne's going to And our contact information is there.
Great. Thank you, Mary.
Mary Armstrong's email address is miarmstr@usf.edu. Svetlana Yampolskaya's email address is yampol@usf.edu. The moderator, Anne Fromnecht, approaches the microphone.
Well, thank you very much to all of our presenters. Really appreciate the time and effort to put this together and share with us. So we'll open it up to questions. Are there any questions for either group? Yes? Oh, they're going to bring a microphone. Just wait one second.
Can you hear me? Okay. What does your caseload look like in Larimer as far as the workers that are doing the assessments?
Thad Paul.
12 to 15. And we recently had a workload study across the state, so there's some new workload money, if you will, that the state was generous to grant. So I think it actually, the focus was reducing that number. Larimer's also, although Colorado's the worst placing state in congregate care, in the nation, we're the lowest and the worst, so I don't know if that means anything, but other than we have a lot of cost savings that we've regenerated into staff and other frontline services. So we're one of the lower caseloads in the state, probably.
What's your total caseload count as far as total cases of children and out of care?
Open at any given time?
Yeah, most recent, just curious.
About 1,200.
And what does the timeliness look like in terms of are they doing it?
Larimer County does really well in a lot of program areas. We don't do well in our IT world or our data world. So we rely much on state and other counties to deliver that. So we don't have a real good system in place to monitor the number of, if the TOPS are being done timely. As part of our consortium, we'll be granted some funding to contract with an individual that's excels in that area, so we're building a system for this next year with our consortium to send emails, generate emails, and do a lot of more tracking specific to you should have done a top by now kind of conversations that allows the supervisors to use that information. What we find is, especially with the youth wanting to have the top, is that when they come into a family meeting, which is facilitated family meeting, they have that conversation, and then it's amazing how quickly things turn around when the kids and the families are asking for it, then they start doing them more frequently. So we're really trying to embed it within the family meeting. That's a conversation that should happen at every family meeting. Has the top been done? What does the information tell us so we can use that information moving forward?
The microphone is moved to address another participant question.
I found the presentation of the NSCAR analysis very interesting. My comment about that is that even the second cohort is a little dated now. So in thinking about the implications for future, if we're thinking about, okay, we're learning here about what we can do in the future regarding measuring and well-being and using mm-hmm. that. Can you comment on that? Mm-hmm.
Mary Armstrong.
Yes, I can. Well, let me just talk. So here's our thinking. Here's the thinking of our evaluation team right now in answer to your question. We are going to continue to use the Florida Department of Children and Families Quality Assurance Program. It's been modified, and actually it just started July 1st. But it is even more aligned than it was with the CFSR standards. So that's one data source that we're going to use. The second data source, Ann mentioned earlier, Medicaid. So in Florida, our Medicaid authority, the Agency for Healthcare Administration, has just like Sheila was saying yesterday, I think we're experiencing across the country a new wave of Medicaid managed care models. And so Florida is totally into integrated care. And the way we defined integrated care in Florida is now all managed care plans in Florida are responsible for physical health, mental health, substance abuse, and pharmacy. So it's very integrated. The other, so that's one piece of it. And then the second strategy that our Medicaid authority is using is they also have what they call specialty care plans for high need populations. So for example, there's a specialty care plan for individuals with HIV/AIDS. One of those specialty care plans is for children in the child welfare system. So we now have a statewide, for any kid, any child who is in our SAQA system, they are receiving physical health, behavioral health, pharmacy from one managed care plan. And so, you know, our belief is that a lot of what, when we talk about child well-being, a lot of the responsibility for it is with the managed care plan. So we have a data use agreement request into our agency for healthcare administration right now. We would like to use that data for our child welfare evaluation. And our the college that I'm in and at the University of South Florida, we already have a policy and services research data center. We have the Medicaid data already. So it's a case of getting permission from our agency for healthcare administration to make use of it. If we get that permission, I mean, I think that actually will be a very primary source of information for us around child well-being.
Yes, over here.
So I was curious, when you talked about the TOPS, the way, if I understood correctly, it's both you're using it with your social workers as well as providers who are contracting with you?
And yeah.
If yes to the providers, do you know off the top of your head costs associated for them to implement?
Thad Paul.
So the cost is all associated to child welfare. How our providers use it is that they get the invites. They are not, they're not using the tool within their system. Does that make sense? So for each child that we open a case service on that's over the age of six, the caseworker is required to do a TOP, and then they send the system allows you to create who's involved with the case, and then it automatically sends invites out. So you click a button, it sends the invites out via email, you click on a link, and then it opens up, and they score the questions based, okay? So you're getting it all, in ideally, within a couple weeks, everybody's getting the same information, and then it feeds the report. And at any point in time, the caseworker can click a button and get those reports I showed, as well as many other reports that kind of can dive much deeper into it. The other thing I didn't mention is the TOP we have a system built in that if there's severe ratings in suicidality and violence, then an automatic email is generated to the supervisor and the caseworker. So we've had multiple occasions where a child rated themselves very high in that area, and caseworkers were unaware of discussions, thoughts that the child was having, and so it actually initiated a response that we may have missed. So the cost associated with us, for us, was worth it for those few interventions that we were able to do.
And Fromnecht.
And if I could a follow-up question on that, how have you engaged the providers, and what strategies have you used to help get their buy-in in order to take the time to actually complete the TOP?
So we've been, Larimer's a little different, but we've been working as a collaboration with our community for a decade plus. So we have really strong standing relationships. We also have a position that no agency does anything that does harm to the other agency, so that's kind of the standing agreement. So we maybe change contract rates to increase the amount of contract that we would provide to them based on the need to do the extra work. The flip side is we're still working, and I heard the initial conversation yesterday about the Medicaid, and Medicaid continues to be a barrier for us, specific around paying for the ability, the time to do the TOP, using that instrument, having therapists and whatnot actually attend family meetings and get to family meetings and some of those other components that are huge drivers of our practice. So it continues to be a work that we're doing within the state of really shifting how we can maximize Medicaid funding, knowing that within a couple years, we will no longer have the 40 funds to lean on to keep all these initiatives moving.
So have you incorporated completion of the TOP into the contracts with the service providers?
Not yet, because we have only a year's worth of data.
Okay.
The goal is to, once we have enough data, then that will become performance drivers, as well as, and really the TOP allows you to really So all those different domains, it'll start breaking down that this provider is really strong in ADHD, but not as in strong in whatever other domain it is. So as you start getting the picture of the child, you are able to then connect them to the correct provider based on the data that we have. We just don't have enough in there yet.
And Fromnecht.
Other questions? Yes, right back here. There's a mic headed your way.
You're gonna get two.
The microphone is moved to address another participant question.
I guess my question kind of builds off on that is, when you use the top, then how do you decide what services to plug in for that youth? Is it something that's pretty systematic that just connects, or do you just go to providers as usual to get what you need?
Thad Paul.
Well, the hope is that it will become systematic. We're not there yet. Ultimately, as part of our contract with CSU to do this research, it is to compare the top based on the different services that they met as well as the child welfare outcomes. So it might help point us at children that have scores in this area and this severe category of this domain, this is the right service, but obviously we're still in elementary school here.
Can you give an example of the providers that you're talking about? Because in order to rate these children, it suggests that they're having frequent contact with them. Mm-hmm. So in what capacity are they seeing these kids?
Thad Paul.
Every 2 to 3 weeks.
But what,
so
what
it's
are
mental
they
health,
actually?
It's our mental health providers. We have multiple what we call core service contracts, which is family preservation contracts, I guess. So it's IFT providers, mental health agencies, substance abuse folks.
How frequently are they seeing these children?
Our providers every 2 to 3 weeks.
Okay, thanks.
Generally.
And Fromnecht.
Other questions? I had a question, Mary, when you were talking about the information that you learned across the CBC lead agencies, mm-hmm. and you mentioned that it was seemed to be fewer reentries when the case management was contracted out. How did you, when you presented those recommendations or those findings to the state, how did they take those recommendations? Were any changes made at a policy level and how the CBCs are operating?
Mary Armstrong.
We had, you know, that's a good question, Ian. So I think in general, we had a good partnership with the department at a policy level. And so what happened in Florida during the first waiver is typically once a year, we would do a presentation to the leadership, the child welfare leadership in Florida, and including legislative staff, key legislative staff that were involved in human services. And there were changes that took place over time. I don't want to take credit completely as the evaluator, but I do, it's interesting because the issue of contracting out case management services, what's kind of happened over time is we've seen many lead agencies take back some functions, especially with high-risk kids. But I think that was their own learning around what you need control over. So I don't know if I'm not going to say there's any policy practice changes that I can attribute only to the evaluation, but I think we were part of a whole feedback loop that was happening with our lead agencies around performance. And I think there's, well, obviously, just like all of you, there was much greater emphasis over time around performance of lead agencies. These public dashboards were being used and things like that.
Man in the audience adds a comment.
Oh, question?
Let me help Mary, since I'm one of the lead agencies in Florida. I think what really occurred, a couple of things you have to understand. Number one, the law requires or only allows the lead agency to only do 35% direct. So therefore, in of itself, the way the system is designed, it encourages the utilization of third parties within the community. So when we got the evaluations, where we started to look at what were the causations of why was that a differential, and then you started looking at, you know, what were the what was the monitoring going on? You know, the DCF was monitoring down to the CBC. What were the monitoring requirements for the CBC? So you really started to develop more focused programming around, mm-hmm. you know, the causations of the differentiations. And what you've seen since then is probably those results are more common across them now. Some of the things that took place is oftentimes you had consolidation where the indirect, the utilization of the resource within the community was pretty widespread early on with respect to utilization of other case management organizations. You see a lot of consolidation. So whereas, like I'm in Jacksonville, we started off with 8 providers providing a case management organization that we were subcontracted to us, but down to 4. You know, so you start getting better economies out of that, and you're able to get more accountability from that. So it's really, you know, over time, you didn't have information. As you got the information, you start making modifications to the program.
Example. Ann Fromnecht.
Other questions? This is a topic that we want to continue the discussion going around as even after this meeting. As I mentioned, we have the base camp page for well-being that all of the evaluators should have received invitations for. If you haven't received an invitation to that, please let us know and we'll be happy to send it. We may be having some follow-up discussions about this additional webinar, so we really want to hear from you as you continue to think about how your waiver is thinking about well-being outcomes and how you're assessing that. What questions do you have? What do you want to hear from other demonstrations about and other evaluation teams about what they've been doing? As Mary mentioned, we have a couple of copies of the journal article that will be out on the JBA resource table, and it's also posted on our Basecamp page. So I just encourage all of you to check that out. And I think then we'll let you out a couple minutes early so you can grab your lunch and come back in for the legislative session. So thank you again to our panelists and enjoy your lunch. Very nice.
The closing slide for the session presents the Center for States logo alongside a logo for the Children's Bureau.